Wah bam ba loom bam ba lam bam bam tooty boot, oh root. Welcome to Analog Jones and the Tempo Film. I'm Steve.
And I'm Matt.
Oh man, you know what? I still don't have a date for prom.
No, you don't?
Nah.
Well, you gotta ask somebody.
Who are you taking?
I'm taking Mary Lou Maloney.
Wait, like Mary Lou the Skank?
She's very nice. She's really sweet, and I think we're gonna have a good time together.
You lucky son of a bitch.
Time to fire up the VCR! This one's my favorite!
Our film that we watched today was Hello Mary Lou, Prom Night 2 from 1987.
Woo! Obviously by the intro, we're talking about Mary Lou Maloney.
All right, before we stick in this VHS, let me give you some details of the whole thing here. We got a rated R film before our PG-13 crap of the 2000s.
The PG-13 of the remake?
Oh, that was PG-13?
Yeah.
Got a 97-minute runtime, so it's a nice, quick hour and a half. Directed by Bruce Pittman. Really, the only thing he's done is a lot of TV.
Yep.
Written by Ron Oliver, who also wrote some scripts for the Goosebumps TV show.
Yeah, and Are You Afraid of the Dark?
Oh, he did both, huh?
Yeah, he did the kids' horror at the time. It feels like that with this movie. It feels like it's from that, Tales from the Crypt light type stuff. That's what it kind of feels like, this whole movie.
It's starring Michael Ironside as Bill Nordham.
Yeah, making the return to Analog Jones very quickly. Didn't take us long to get back to Ironside.
He's a classic Joneser.
Yeah.
We've got Wendy Lyon as Vicki Carpenter. Carpenter.
The first of many callback last names.
I'm going to jack this one up. Louis Ferreira? As Greg Nordham.
Yeah, and he's credited in this movie as Justin Lewis.
Yes, yeah, I saw that.
His first sort of name.
And Lisa Schrage as Mary Lou Maloney.
Oh, who is just fucking amazing in this film.
Yeah, there's very few people who can outdo Michael Ironside, but I think we just found one in a film.
Yeah, she just rips apart the screen when she is on it.
Mm-hmm. We've got, this is a Canadian slasher. Actually, the first four are all Canadian.
Yes.
Released October 16th, 1987 in Canada, but the reason we're doing this is it wasn't released into the United States until November of 87.
Right. Yes, so this is our first of our breakdown of each month. So we're in November now, so all of our two episodes in November will be November releases.
Mm-hmm.
So this is one that came out after Halloween in the U.S. and did well on video, you said.
It did. The budget is about $1.5 to $2 million, so it's a solid budget. We do get some good production in this.
Yeah, no, it's all on screen. And we looked up that it ended up making about $2.8 million in the U.S., so made its budget back. Not a huge hit or anything, but really became a hit on video.
No, this was all about the video during this day.
I love that so far a lot of the movies we've covered were movies that became hits on video. I think that really ties into our nostalgia aesthetic.
I think it was a common trade back then where these budget, you know, you get about $1 million to $2 million ones. They don't really care about the theater release. It's all about home video.
Yeah, the 80s. It was the Wild West, and money was just being printed for these tapes.
Yeah. All right, we're going to listen to the trailer right here, and then we're going to come back with the box art.
Vicky's getting ready for the prom.
Morning, prom queen.
Only nominated, not the winner.
But she's about to get a visit from the past.
I've been seeing things. Hallucinations about Mary Lou Maloney. That girl who died at our school.
The mind plays strange tricks.
It's not my mind. Damn you, it's Mary Lou Maloney!
We're in trouble, you and I.
What are you talking about?
Mary Lou Maloney has come back.
It's like I'm not in control of myself. I am afraid I might hurt somebody.
Somehow her spirit has come back from the grave and she will come after you and me.
This is the part where Analog Jones breaks down the box art, and by that, I mean Matt. Tell us why we'd rent this.
So you're strolling through the video store. Actually, this was one that I, like Urban Legend we were talking about, this was one I was strolling through the video store and picked up this box and had to see this movie. Great art. So we've got our title, Hello Mary Lou, Prom Night 2, and a Very Tales from the Crypt-y comic book kind of font up at the top.
Mm-hmm.
And then we get Mary Lou, an illustrated Mary Lou, in a locker that's on fire. Looks so cool. She's in like a 50s style pink-purple dress with the gloves and the crown, as she calls it, in the movie. And yeah, she's got the flames behind her. We get the painted looking up aesthetic at the lockers, almost like a Goosebumps cover. And on the lockers to her left, to my right, she's got the names of different students that are crossed off. We got Mary, Dave, Dan, Bud, Billy written down, and Dave, Dan, and Bud are crossed off. Not actually characters in the film, but it's just a fun little thing.
Wait,
that they
is Bud?
Just,
did you say Bud is on?
Yeah, Bud's on here.
I think Bud wasn't Bud the original guy. Bud Strikes Again.
Oh, okay. Yeah, yeah. The Bud was the yeah. You're right. It's almost like her list of like people she was with, because Bill is not crossed off, and that was Michael Ironside.
Mm-hmm.
So we do get two names that do appear in the movie. The tagline on here is: in 1957, Mary Lou Maloney went up in flames. Spaces. Now she's back, and she's burning mad. My least favorite tagline of all the taglines we looked at, but it's fun.
Yeah, after you're done describing this, I'll go into the other ones.
So that's her front. Great painted image. Like I said, almost like a Tales from the Crypt-y, Goosebumps-y type cover, painted. It's awesome.
Who's the signature on that?
We get a Samuel Goldwyn Home Entertainment signature at the bottom. This was a Samuel Goldwyn release in theaters, so they've got their name on the box here, even though this is a Video Treasures release. So on the sides, we've got the red. So this really stands out on your shelf. The red coloring, R rating, closed caption, all that. The image from the front and the little top corners, and red on top as well. Red back. So very red, sides, top, and back. And here's the back
of
the box.
Well, they always
here.
Want the back of the box to catch your attention.
Yeah, this one really does. So, Hello Mary Lou, Prom Night 2, up at the top. And now this is the tagline that's on one of the other boxes that I really like. It's the first line of the description. You can't keep a bad girl down. Simple and effective. I really like that. Beautiful and innocent Vicki Carpenter seems a shoo-in for prom queen, but Mary Lou Maloney, dead for 30 years, also wants the crown and returns from the grave to possess Vicki's body. After tormenting and brutally butchering Vicki's friends, Mary Lou successfully transports panic-stricken Vicki into a hellish purgatory. With a competition out of the way, hell-bent and armed with deadly powers, Mary Lou's got places to go, people to kill, and a crown to win. Richard Harrington from the Washington Post calls Hello Mary Lou Prom Night 2 clever, with humor and class. It's Peggy Sue Lives on Elm Street with dollops of Carrie and The Exorcist. 1987, color, approximately 97 minutes. And like I mentioned, this is a Video Treasures release from 1995, so this is a re-release. Video Treasures was like a precursor to Anchor Bay, would put out movies that sort of were floating in distribution. And the artwork is credited to 1988, so that's probably when they created this.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And it's in mono. We get a mono, not a stereo sound one, so one single speaker for this one.
Oh, we had to turn the audio up on my TV.
Yeah,
so.
Single speaker tends to be that way. Last thing I wanted to point out about this VHS, so we could slip the cover off for now. The tape itself is listed as Hello Mary Lou, and then in parentheses, Prom Night 2.
Yeah, I don't that's know who did the one. Printing on the this cassette, but that's weird.
And then they also mislabeled the running time. They have it as 104 minutes.
Well, these interns just aren't what they used to be.
Right? Oh, God. These people probably got paid for this, though. yeah, that's kind of our cover. Oh, the images on the back are really cool. They look like production stills, not so much pictures clipped from the movie. These are... The characters are looking into the lens. So these are production photos of Ironside's up on top with the blood from a nightmare scene mm-hmm. that he has. We get the great effects work on Mary Lou as she's transitioning from burnt corpse Mary Lou to pretty Mary Lou with slight scarring. We get like the in-between stage of her. And then we get...
Which is a man...
Yeah, which is clearly like a one of the effects guys. Or maybe it was
a skinny effects guy.
Maybe yeah. It was a puppet, too. I don't know, because when she was changing, there was some... Yeah, it could have been a puppet, could have been a person. Yeah. I don't know. And then, finally, like the image of her, you know, raising hell on prom night, 87, Mary Lou. So she's got the slight scarring. Yeah, great images to really convey sort of the poppy... pulpy fun of the movie.
So we actually had a couple VHS covers for this, so I'll go back into the history for it. I did some research. We had a Canadian version, which was distributed by North Star Home Video. This was the original release distributed by it. And it's Mary Lou standing at the top of the stairs with the light like bleeding through where it just makes a silhouette of her.
Which is a shot in the movie.
Which is a shot in a movie. And her tagline in that on the front is what's on the back of this VHS cover that we have is you can't keep a bad girl down. But don't worry, we've got many more taglines for you.
Yeah.
So the U.S. originally distributed this by Virgin Vision, which I had mentioned to you before. I've never heard of.
Yeah, I think that was like a very quick, you know, Virgin Records getting in on the distribution of VHS.
Well, I was wondering if it was Virgin Records.
Yeah, it's the same logo. So I think that was them getting in on that, but they didn't seem to last very long in the VHS distribution. They went back to records.
So we've got this version, which we have right now, which is also the U.S. version of it, but we have a few other things in here. One of the taglines on it, on the Canadian poster, was Mary Lou is back. God help the students at Hamilton High.
Yeah.
So they got to make sure to get Hamilton High in there.
Because that's the connective tissue between this one and the first one.
We've got another one on the U.S. poster here, which is Mary Lou is one hot date. She's got places to go. ... People to kill.
Which is... in the description on the back.
Yes.
Here, but not
that. But it was definitely a tagline. So the U.S. had two different posters. One, which is her in the locker room with the flames, which we get on the distributed slip covers. But then they had another one, I guess, for PG-13 type video stores where there's no flames on it. I don't understand why you do that. I guess you can't burn a girl.
Yeah, the flames... The flames were okay for a video store, but it looked like the flames weren't okay for the theatrical poster, kind
yeah,
of.
Yeah, that's odd to me. I don't. You never know what they're going to do with these, distributing these posters and everything like that. So, we'll come back and we'll break down this film.
Yeah, we'll take it out to the sleeve here, we'll pop it in, and we'll get to what's on the tape.
Mary Lou Maloney wants to be the prom queen all over again.
No!
Hello, Mary Lou. Prom Night 2 on USA tomorrow at 9, 8 Central.
Let's fire up this VCR, Matt. Let's break this thing down.
Yeah, so we pop the tape in. We don't get any trailers, unfortunately, this time.
Wah, wah.
Which always bums me out.
Well,
but
it's a video treasure... trope now for us.
Yeah, Video Treasure, I think being a re-release company, doesn't want to fucks with that. So we just get the Video Treasure's logo. We get the FBI warning, which is now our second time getting an FBI warning.
Mm-hmm. And fix the tracking.
And fix and adjust your tracking. So a lot of little nostalgic bits there with the FBI warning and the adjust your tracking. I think this tape is in EP mode, so the cheap shit.
Mm-hmm.
Less tape to pay for. in the role.
So when we're looking through horror movies, or any movies, when we see a video treasure, we can both look at each other and be like, this is only a dollar here.
Yeah, like, do we want to risk it and miss out on some trailers, or should we look for the original? But this was one that I had already in my collection, just because I wanted to own the movie. So yeah, this is Video Treasures is our first logo, and then a gesture tracking FBI warning, we jump right into the movie.
Mm-hmm. And then we get an opening shot of Miss Mary Lou going into confession.
Yes. So we get a confession scene, and she writes basically for good time call on there because she lists all of her sins, and they're all like amazing. There she's like, I have
unpure thoughts,
and I've done things with the boys in school or whatever. And the priest is just like, wow. What? And then she's just like, and I loved every second of it. And she writes her name and lipstick in the confessional.
And then it cuts to the chess, which is something they don't set up at all. So we've got just a shot of a creepy chest.
Mm-hmm.
And a really cool chest, by the way.
Yeah, like a trunk chest, yeah. Like an old school carrying case trunk. Which is, we're assumed, is filled with Mary Lou's soul.
Sure. then we go right to prom.
Yeah, we get to prom. We get to see Mary Lou in action. And God, is she so good in this movie.
Yeah, she knows what movie she's doing. And since it's prom, I think we should bake out our prom cakes we've got here.
Okay, so I'm just going to be eating through the rest of this episode. Great. So
this episode's going to sound for the rest of it like this. This is really good.
So we get the prom, which is awesome. She's with a 30-year-old date who's balding. might be the same age as Ironside is in this movie, but it's supposed to be a young Ironside.
I looked it up for us. Mary Lou is 31, but she looks great for 31.
Yeah, and she looks like she could pass as a movie high schooler. Like, you know, she's probably in her 20s, but pass for a teenager.
And then the guy playing Billy in this, which ends up being Michael Ironside's character. Billy is 33, going on 40.
Yeah, he does not look good. So they're on a date. And he gets stiffed because she ends up making out with Bud, who strikes again.
Damn that Bud!
He's pumping her full of liquor, and they're making out. And Billy
catches
her. She's
grabbing the crotch.
Oh yeah, she is. She is aggressive, and I like it. She is so fun to watch.
So when Billy walks back there and he catches them making out, she's like, what? We ain't doing anything. He's like, what? You're grabbing his crotch.
They're not fucking, so they ain't doing anything.
I guess that's how this works. So it ends up she wins the prom queen. And when she wins it, she struts. She owns that stage. And I love this whole 50s thing. You've got the everyone in their garb. And like I said when we were watching it, I love the gloves.
Oh, yeah. Great costume choice, very 50s period. We get a lot of 50s songs. It really fits in with the times. It's cool. Great costume.
Tutti Frutti, one of the best songs ever originally written about anal sex.
Yes.
Look it up. It's true.
Yeah.
So, Billy's pissed. Billy ends up getting a stink bomb that two pranksters were going to use, but they had to ditch it. So he waits up there when she's like, I forget what she says to the girl, but she's like, forget the robe, bonehead. Give me the crown.
Yeah.
So she's about to get her crown, but right before she does, young Billy throws a stink bomb to ruin it and sets her on a flame. She just explodes.
Yeah, she erupts into flames, and Bud goes to save her with this jacket. But, you know, doesn't want to get burned as well, so he doesn't make it, like, banging on the stairs, which, of course, leads him to a life of priestdom.
Yes.
After, you know, being the guy that was sneaking around the alcohol and stuff like that.
He gets an honorable mention for trying.
Mm-hmm.
So she burns to death, and then we get a cut to modern time.
Well, first we go to the trunk. We get this great pan back shot. Again, very, very goosebumpsy, very Tales from the Crypty. The trunk sort of like closes, and then we pan back and we see a skull on the floor. We don't know if it's hers. Doesn't fucking matter. It's just cool. It looks cool. We're recording this right before Halloween, and it's very Halloween-y.
Yes.
So we get that shot. And once we get that shot, we realize, like, that, okay, her soul is now trapped in this trunk after she's burned up at prom. And fast forward to 1987, 30 years later.
And they show us, they don't tell us, because we just, honestly, when I first watched this film, I just assumed it was modern time. But you picked up, hey, they never gave us a cue for it.
Show don't tell, though. You know, it works.
It works.
Can very much tell that it is the 80s.
And this film, within 10 minutes, shows all the characters for it. Mm-hmm. They do not waste time setting this up. First, we get Vicki, which is a innocent girl, kind of this very, very conservative 1980s, wearing like these docker khaki. Oh, these khakis are awful.
Very covered up. Her mother is Nancy Reagan in the film.
Her mother is awful. But her dad seems like such a joy.
He's so sad. You know, there's just such a deep sadness in his life.
Can you imagine their sex? It's got to be like nothing.
It's probably like two by fours just rubbing together and creating friction.
Maybe the greatest visual of awful sex I've ever heard.
Yeah. So that's probably what their sex life is like. But I'm sure it gets a renewed vitalization after later on in the film when he makes out with his daughter.
Oh, you just ruined it now!
And he seems to, like, take pleasure from it. So he was probably like, hey, honey, want to hook up tonight? And he was probably thinking of his kid. Anyway, so...
we go to her dreamy boyfriend on a bicycle, picks her up. They go to the diner. Apparently these kids in the 80s not only go to the diner, but drink coffee?
Yeah, it's a very 50s thing, but I think it was sort of that conservative Reagan-era 80s. I know this is Canada, but still, like, they're kind of doing the American tropes here.
Yep. So we've got four characters right there within, like, maybe 4 minutes.
Yeah, and they're doing sort of the conservative 80s, remember the 50s thing by going to the diner and, you know, very Back to the Future type stuff. So, yeah, we sort of learn their characters. The boyfriend is... you know, the bad boy with a heart of gold. Mm-hmm. He's got the motorcycle, and the parents think that he's bad for her, but he's actually really a nice guy. He's, like, a really good dude and really cares about her.
Yeah, he's not a bad guy at all. In fact, he's quite wonderful.
Yeah, he's so nice to her. He, like, supports her individuality, like, and when she starts to change, he's like, oh, she's just doing her thing.
She's been an individual, y'all.
Yeah, like, he's so nice for, like, the motorcycle leather jacket wearing bad boy of the 80s.
Then we go to school, and we get a kid... we get the geek of the school, the 80s geek, and I love him. He's introducing, one, a guacamole radio, which then he goes, didn't work well because it only picked up Mexican radio stations. And I looked you right now and I go, this script writer is having a blast. Because he's writing these teeny jokes everywhere. And it's not so much like a laugh out loud, it's a hee hee.
There's one-liners throughout the entire film, start to finish. Yeah. Like, and it is, it's just little things like that. Like, I tried to set up a guacamole radio, I was only getting Mexican. But, and that's it. Like, that's like the end of it. It's never addressed again. It's like these little dropped one-liners that go throughout the movie.
And Vicky's talking to her friend Jessica, I believe.
Pregnant one?
No, non-pregnant one. This is the Monica. One where she's Monica. She's like, I'm 18, I'm gorgeous, and none of the boys like me.
And then a guy is like, hey, can I talk to you after school? And she's like, fuck off.
Get away from me, you dirtbag.
And then she turns back towards the camera and goes, I don't know why I can't get a date to prom.
I'm like, this script writer's just loving it. Can you imagine him watching them deliver all these lines when they're shooting? Oh. He's just like this. Ooh, yeah.
But like, a great example of an 80s movie where sort of everybody gets it. Everybody knows the tone. Like, they are delivering this humor with such glee. But then, yeah, it's you know, an effects-heavy horror movie. They get what they're doing. They're having a blast with this.
And then they show the super, super 80s woman here, which I think Matt, her friend, is going to the doctor, and she's like, are you okay? And I see the glimmer in Matt's eyes when he sees this most ridiculous 80s girl. Yes. I'm going to let you describe what she's wearing.
First of all, her hair looks like she stuck about 97 forks in an outlet at one time. It is fried. It is huge. It is touching the ceiling. She has to duck when she goes through doorways. It's so big. Which is already fantastic. And her makeup is just like clown level. And then she's wearing like a jumpsuit that looks like if like the Joker was a character on Miami Vice. Like, and then her purse, I thought was a helmet, like a bike helmet, but it looks more, because they showed it then in a close-up, it looks more like if somebody found a dinosaur egg and turned it into a purse. This woman is my spirit animal.
Oh, man. She was something. At some point, they also introduced the bitch character who becomes the true competition for prom queen, because it took me the second viewing of this film to realize, oh, all the girls, they waste time. Well, they don't waste time. All the girls they set up in this, they're all going for prom queen.
Yeah, they're all on the ballot running for prom queen. And yeah, basically Mary Lou's MO is knocking off the competition.
Yeah, I mean...
Which they don't explicitly say it, but it's like...
Yeah, they show it.
It's actually better that they don't explicitly say that. Like, it's better that, like, it's like you kind of learn that as it's going on. It's like, oh, she's taking off the competition.
I don't believe this film ever actually drops exposition.
No, they really show you everything. Yeah, this moves. I mean, Ron Oliver, who wrote this, and like we mentioned, did Goosebumps and like 17 episodes of Goosebumps, and, like 17 episodes of Are You Afraid of the Dark, is a prolific writer, though. He's got a ton. He's got like 60-something writing credits on his IMDb.
This man is a professional.
He knows what he's doing. He's not going to be dropping exposition. Like, they know how to just keep going. And he is the one who directed some of the reshoots, and we'll talk about that in the behind the scenes. So he knows what he's doing with this movie.
Well, and then they cut to Michael Ironside is the principal, and then you figure out him and his kid Craig here. So Michael Ironside is now the older version of Billy that caught Mary Lou on fire. And he's been rewarded in life for being a murderer as a principal.
Right, he is the principal of the school. I don't think it never shows, though, that he got caught doing it.
I don't think people know. No.
I think people just thought it was an accident, like somebody
only
had
Mary Lou knows.
Right. So nobody knows that he's the reason she caught on fire.
Oh, maybe Bud knows.
Bud didn't see him do it, though.
Hmm.
I think he confesses to Bud. He's like, she's coming after us because of what we did or whatever, or what we didn't do. So Ironside is now the principal of the school, and his kid is Craig. So that explains why Mary Lou also decides to possess...
Yes.
Vicky, because she's dating Craig, who is the son of her boyfriend. So it makes sense that that's who
like
she would
It's like a revenge possess. Tactic. Yeah. It's good. They did a good job. But really, then they show the priest, which you find out is Bud. And I look down at the timer on this. They put in all the characters within 10 minutes.
Right. We know everybody who's going to be in the movie. We know everybody who's on the ballot. We know, like, who's the bitch girl, who's the nice girl, who's the pregnant girl, who's our lead. You know, we know everybody. We know about Mary Lou. We know about Billy and Bud. We now have all of our characters for the film.
Yeah, we find out that the art girl, super 80s girl that Matt loves...
Yes.
...is pregnant.
Yes. We find that out pretty quick.
In the slowest pan I have ever seen. Because she freaks out when they're all like... we forgot to mention. Art girl... Vicki asks art girl, hey, what kind of dress are you going to wear? She goes, I don't know. I'm just going to go downstairs and props and find one. And Vicky's just like, great idea. Waste no time. Immediately goes down there.
Yeah, does it before her friend who suggested it. Like she might end up getting the dress that her friend wanted. But when she goes down there... She finds the trunk that encases Mary Lou's soul and naturally opens it, and the soul is released through, you know, supernatural movings arounds of objects and things like
that. Sure.
That's how we know it escapes, like trunks and stuff are moving on their own.
I don't know about your high school, but we did not have a basement.
Yeah, I think our like basement was like just another extension of the gym. That's like where the ROTC kids practice. Basically that was our high school. Basement. We didn't really have like a traditional like boiler room like all these horror movies have.
No.
She opens up the trunk. She gets a dress because her mom, her Nancy Reagan mom, won't let her have a nice dress.
Was there a dress in there or just the cape? Cape and crown, I think.
Oh, yeah. She finds the cape and crown first, but she was going down for a dress because her Nancy Reagan mom won't let her wear a nice dress.
And then we get to the girls talking about prom and 80s girl... freaks out. Then Vicky goes to consult her. We find out she's pregnant. Then we get the long zoom in panning
dramatic as she's confessing and being like, it's going to be okay. You'll get through this. You'll get through this.
And then within 15 minutes, we get our first death.
Who is the pregnant girl?
Who is the pregnant girl? Woo! So technically, it's two deaths.
Yeah, waste no time being like, hey, audience. Yeah. No one is safe.
And Mary Lou here has a little hard time deciding how to kill 80s girl.
Yeah, so 80s girl is like, I'm going to try on this cape and crown. And Mary Lou is not having
nope,
it now that her soul is up.
No.
So she tries on the cape, and then she picks a stone out of the crown, because I think she wants to just keep the stone, not the crown. And that sets Mary Lou off, wraps the cape around her neck, and supernaturally pulls her across the room in a very spectacularly, like, fans blowing, everything is flying the room, 80s moment. Awesome. And pulls her to the paper cutter that they have in schools, with the big arm blade, and is about to cut her head off, and is like, no, change my mind. The arm blade flies back up. She flies across that and gets yanked up in the air and is like strangled. Her neck is like bleeding and everything. She's strangled in the air, but Mary Lou's not done.
No.
That's not good enough. She fucking throws her through the window.
Yeah, because I thought, oh, she didn't cut off her head because she wants it to look like a suicide. Then she tosses her out the window, and I'm like, well, Mary Lou's just kind of learning her power. She has no idea what she wants to do yet.
Right. Yeah, and I think that's what it is. I think she's just like, she's first released now, so she's just learning her power. So where do we go after this?
Vicki,
this is when, like, sort of the plot just...
It starts to go pretty quick. So yeah. Vicky's distraught, which apparently only Vicki is distraught.
Yeah, like one of their friends and like one of the people who is running for prom queen is dead. And like, they're just like, man, that sucks.
Yeah, I know. She's just like, isn't it weird that she's not around? Yeah. And then the other girl comes up. She's like, she's promoting to be prom queen. She's like, you guys better catch up because one person's already dropped out.
Yeah.
And then she looks at her and what does she say? She's like, you bitch.
She says something like, shut the fuck up, you bitch.
Like, and I was like, whoa, woo.
And that is the first sign that she is going to be possessed.
Yeah, we also
by
get the
Mary Lou.
We get the volleyball scene, too, where she starts to have these delusions. She gets caught in the volleyball net, and then she gets sent home, and they're like, oh, she fainted. No, she didn't. The bitch character smokes her in the head with a volleyball.
Yeah, spikes the volleyball into her face and knocks her out. But yeah, when she gets knocked out, she's having visions of the 50s.
We call that assault nowadays, but in the 80s, it's just like being goofy.
Yeah, it's like kids are just, they're just kids. They're just kids playing with each other. It's assault, kids. Don't fucking throw spike balls into people you don't like's faces.
Yeah, and then basically the mom's just like, you gotta go to confessional. You gotta go to church. That's why you fainted. Like,
yeah.
What?
And basically all that does is ignite Mary
Lou.
Yeah,
that starts to...
within her, taking over.
Yeah, somehow she ends up entering her body. She gets into her room, and we see Vicki, who's got the cleanest little room. She's got paint all around it. You know, you can tell she's an art student. She's drawing, but then the drawing turns from her to Mary Lou.
Right, and then her fucking rocking horse in her room is the creepiest fucking thing. Its eyes turn red, its mouth starts moving, its head moves, and then it sexually sticks its tongue out. It's pretty great.
And we get that mirror of her room where it's kind of ripple effect.
Yeah, it's like water, water, and the hand starts to come out.
That's cool. That was really cool.
It's a great scene when she's like, the possession is finally taking hold.
And we'll skip through this. Most of this is just setting up that the dance is coming and everything like that and her friends. But then we get another one where she enters a dream state, which definitely this is all based off of Nightmare on Elm Street.
Right. It's
this
sort
is an
of,
homage to
it's,
it.
It's Exorcist, Carrie, Elm Street.
Yeah.
All smushed together, which works fabulously in this movie, though.
Yeah, I think this is really well done, and these effects people are having a blast, because then we get her in the cafeteria, we look down, and there's giant hissing cockroaches crawling around in this disgusting soup
that's just filled with worms and whatever.
Ugh.
yeah it's nasty. So that's one of her flashbacks to the 50s, but it's this rotten ghost 50s.
Her character is starting to snap here. She's not getting sleep, but what in this whole like middle segment of the movie, they're setting it up. Everyone kind of acts like Vicky's crazy for no reason. She has a reason. Her best friend's dead.
Her pregnant best friend is, she is being told, killed herself. Like, what the fuck? That's like, and they're still trying to put on prom. And obviously, because we see her setting up for prom, she's like head of the prom committee. So she's got a setup for a prom that she was going to go to with her best friend who she thinks committed suicide. I'd be a little fucked up, too.
Like, yeah, I don't know if this is, like, a normal thing in Canada where everyone's just like, oh, you know, they all killed themselves. Move on.
Yeah. Yeah. I think they're just like, I mean, if you think about it, though, high school kids, they are really all about themselves. They could really give a shit about each other. Unless it is your close friend. Like, you're really still focused on yourself. You're not exactly the most compassionate person in high school.
Well, and at this point, Michael Ironside's character Billy and the priest Bud, they know what's happening. They've seen all these signs, the cracked mirror, the...
Yeah, they know Mary Lou's coming back. And, yeah, like, Bill lets Bud know again, like, this was my fault. She's coming back because of me. And Bud is like, we'll perform an exorcism, and...
Billy's not into that.
Yeah, but he's like, you're being ridiculous. That's not going to help. We're just doomed. And Bud tries to do an exorcism at the church and at her gravesite, and that just pisses her off.
We do get a little bit of some light moments between this. The nerd who asks out the girl who's like, why has no one asked me out?
Right.
He asks her out, gets a nice little kiss, and you're like, aw.
That's a really sweet scene. Like, that it could be a scene in, like, a coming-of-age high school movie, because he's like, well, if we go to the prom and we meet together, people won't know we're together, so that's okay. And she's like, yeah, we wouldn't want that to happen. We could end up kissing, and then people will know we're together. And he's like, we can't have that. And then she's like, but we could kiss now and get that over with. And then the nerd gets his kiss.
Yeah.
It's a really sweet scene.
He also gets a little, a word I'm searching for. He tries to get a little bit more. He's just like, well, you want to try anything else? Yeah. And I'm like, whoa, don't get greedy.
Yeah,
there,
don't
buddy.
Get greedy here. Like, you got a little peck on the cheek, so just take that.
But sadly, she will never make it to prom.
Right. So we get that amazing scene, which is super sweet, super cute. And this is Monica, who is like the second best friend of Vicky. And so that turns into Vicky's now kind of gone a little loony. She's kind of really pale.
She's looking good.
Well, she was, for a while, she was a little pale, had sunken eyes, and now she's starting to, like, look like 50s hot.
Mm-hmm.
Like, she's kind of changing her outfit, changing her makeup, and she's walking around with all this confidence. Like, the actress changes her walk, changes her tone of voice. She doesn't necessarily change so much about her appearance other than,
some lipstick.
Some
and
lipstick
stuff,
and stuff. But she completely changes within her performance. So she's great in these scenes. But they're in a shower scene together, and she's kind of being sassy with her. And Monica's like, you need to cut this out, whatever. And she goes to take a shower.
Oh, and we get boobs.
Yeah, and we get Monica boobs, and then we also get Vicky full frontal.
Yeah.
She drops the towel and goes in the shower with Monica and, like, starts giving her little pecs. And she's like, what are you doing?
Yeah,
what are you doing?
And I'm not into this, Vicky.
And she freaks her out. And Vicky's, like, chasing her naked through the, in a very faculty-like moment.
Yeah, she's just walking naked. I mean, she kind of turns into Jason here.
She's slow walking and Monica's running away, but she's still keeping up with her.
Yeah. It's called magic, folks.
So Monica gets away by hiding in a locker. And she, you know, she's like, oh, she's going to see me. And Vicky comes around the corner and is like, you think she doesn't know which locker it is? And then she fucking looks right at the locker. And in this great effects moment, the lockers just sort of crush into that middle one. And then a bunch of just blood oozes out from the middle where we know Monica just got smushed.
Yeah, I was like, Monica, I really wanted you to live. But you're dead. And your fake boobs won't make it to prom.
Yeah, this was the 80s. There's nothing fake about Vicky. She's got a slammin' body.
The scene actually really surprised me. I was like, wow, this actress is going all in. And when she's walking, she literally, it's almost like Mary Lou did enter her body.
I mean, right, she's got the Mary Lou strut that, like, yeah, that you see Mary Lou have in the opening scene. So it's really nice, actually. It's a really good performance. She's walking around with, like, such poise and confidence. You're like, fuck, that is Mary Lou now.
We'll skip some of the other stuff, but, the one girl, Kelly, was it?
That's the bitch girl.
Yeah, the Kelly bitch girl tries to pay off the nerd to win the prom, and he doesn't do it. No, she's like, I'll give you $100, whatever, name your price, and he writes something on the computer, which we figure out is blowjob.
Yeah.
And she's like, you're disgusting, and then takes a dart and throws it through Albert Einstein's nose, and I'm like, hey! The fuck did Albert Einstein?
Yeah, he's got an Einstein poster in his nerd den. Of course he does.
Because we have to remind everyone he's a nerd.
He's the nerd, yeah. So, you know, this guy, he really is greedy because he's got the hot girl to go to prom with, but he's mm-hmm. still looking to get a BJ from the bitch girl. Ugh. Greedy nerds.
He is playing the game here.
Yeah, he's playing the high school game for sure.
So then we basically just get to prom.
Well, the priest dies.
Oh, that's right. He's doing kind of an exorcist, I guess. The body of Christ compels you.
No, that he does the exorcism early on. That just pisses her off.
Yeah.
But later, Vicki goes to the confessional, much like the opening scene of the movie where Mary Lou goes to the confessional. Confesses to Bud. Bud now realizes, like, it's over. Like, this, she is Mary Lou, and she's gonna kill him, and she breaks through the door and stabs him with the crucifix.
Bud's not gonna make it.
So he gets stabbed in the face with the crucifix, and that's it for Bud. But then we get to prom.
Yes, and right before prom, we have two kind of key scenes in it. We'll break it off, fork it off here. So we get Billy, Michael Ironside's character, who knows Mary Lou has risen, and he is going to make sure, he's going to find out if she's, like, you know, the Walking Dead. He goes to her gravesite in a cardigan. He puts on his suit of armor, which is a cardigan.
Which is his cardigan.
He goes to he digs up the grave. The priest is in there.
Right. Mary Lou isn't in there. The priest that just got stabbed in the mouth is in there.
So then we also have Vicki, who is possessed by Mary Lou at this time, in her dress, and she's looking good in a rocking chair, and her dad comes in there, and he's doing his whole, you know, you're going to remember this forever. Your mom and I thought we were the best-looking couple. I was doing repossessions at that time, and my first check I spent on her corsage and a ring. And, you know, that's... it's going to be, you're going to remember this forever. Vicki just gets up, struts over, and starts making out with her dad. And I was like, whoa, no returning from this.
And he looks like he likes it. A little bit. He's like, it's sort of a look like, why do I like this so much? And then the mom is like, get out of here, you harlot. And that's the last we see of the parents.
Well, she goes downstairs, and this is definitely the carry to the mom thing, too. And she's like, you're not leaving this house. Vicki just looks at her and just blows her through the door.
Yeah, like kind of mind, like, nods, and she fucking goes flying through the front door.
Just,
and it's like
Jean Grazer here.
Yeah.
Boom!
Yeah, and so mom is just laying on the deck of the house, or the front porch of the house, and then, like, Vicki struts off going to prom with Craig, who still is just, like, being really nice and supportive to her. Like, she's just trying new things. She's just trying to be an individual.
First... You know, at the one time, Vicki, before all this, Vicky's making out with Craig and, like, grabs his crotch, and she's like, what, you don't know how to use this? And then she drops the F word, and I was like, whoa.
Yeah, very 80s, but also 50s, you know, where it was okay to say the F word.
The other F word, yeah, the F-A-G.
Yeah, the other bad word, which we won't say because we're better than that. But she does that, and yeah, and then, like, she's, like, being really mean to the people that are setting up for the prom and stuff like that. So, Craig is still just being super supportive of her.
And then Craig's dad knocks him out so he can't go to the... I'm like, man, Craig is really a doormat in this.
Yeah, like, because his dad is Michael Ironside. Just knocks him out. And he's like, I'm going to go take care of this.
I'm going to go dig up this grave. Uh-oh, she's not there. So then Michael
Ironside...
So he just
gets a fucking gun.
there's only one way to take out a ghost demon.
Yeah. Got a shooter.
So he goes to the prom. We get that the one girl, the girl that will do nothing or will do anything to win this prom, goes back to the nerd geek who's just pounding beers because his prom date never showed up.
Who was Monica because she's smashing a locker dead somewhere.
And no one's found her apparently.
Yeah, no one's found her yet.
So she comes in there with, I guess, mouthwash or the spray or
whatever. Yeah, the mouth spray, yeah.
Gives him a little BJ, and while he's getting the BJ, he writes in that she wins.
Right. So he types in the computer that she's the winner now because he got what he wanted. He got his blowjob. And she leaves and goes to make out with her boyfriend, and the boyfriend's like, "You taste good."
It's like, oh.
It was so gross and great.
Again, screenwriter going, yes!
Yeah, just a great silly moment. So we think that Kelly's going to win, and Mary Lou is not having that. So she like takes over the computer and makes the nerd kid's face explode with lightning lasers.
Yeah, animators had a lot of fun with that scene.
Yeah, so he like melts after sort of after that. So he's dead now, and Mary Lou changes the computer.
Which she they show it on the
wrong,
computer.
Yeah. Dead wrong. was what it was typed on there. So she makes it so that Vicki wins. And Vicki then wins, and Kelly's like, "What the fuck?" She looks so disgusted with herself.
And the one guy looks over and he goes,
"How did you blow this one?
How did you blow this? I can't even get it out. I was laughing so hard."
Yeah, great line there. And then, like, Vicki goes up because she won, and fucking Michael Ironside shows up and just fucking shoots her.
In front of everywhere, and then Craig shows up and he's like, "Oh, Dad, what did you do?" It's like, "Well, you just killed the demon, boy."
And then, in this great 80s practical effects extravaganza, Mary Lou crawls out of the body of Vicki. Like,
yeah, rips right through the gun hole.
Yeah, with the hand, and then she pulls the rest of her body out, and she's all fucked up and burnt.
And I think it's on the back of the VHS slip.
Yeah, so we sort of get the stages. Every time it cuts back to people freaking out at prom and cuts back to Mary Lou, she's like getting less and less burned and fucked up. But she's like basically a burnt, charred skeleton when she first comes out, and then it's like more and more flesh grows on her and stuff like that. It's great. Great effect.
And she's tearing everything up, and then she kills. Not only does she make Jessica, is that her name?
What, the bitch girl?
Oh, yeah, what was
Kelly?
Kelly. Not only did Kelly give a BJ, not win the whole thing, get kind of mocked, then then Mary Lou throws like a light and stabs her and kills her.
Yeah, like she, one of the neon lights that's lighting up the prom, she just rips from the ceiling and just like stabs her, and Kelly, she's dead.
Kelly was pretty much my favorite bitch character on there, even though I couldn't remember her name. But man, she is
she was so sassy. Yeah. She's great.
But she is dead.
Yeah, she gets rotted. So she gets stabbed with the lightning rod.
And Craig tries to save the day. He, I don't know, hits Mary Lou over the back with a chair or something, and then Mary Lou just looks up, "Now you're pissing me off," and just starts tossing him
around. Yeah, he's just like, it's like a rag doll. It's so good. She's so great in this movie.
And it was weird because he runs away, and she makes this rope wrap around his leg, and I was like, "Uh-oh, what's going to happen?" And he just goes, takes off the rope like nothing.
Yeah.
And then runs away. And I'm like, "Mary Lou, what's that?"
Well, she was distracted because Ironside's still there, and so she wants to kill Craig, I think, in front of Ironside's to get a revenge.
Yeah, maybe.
So
They run downstairs.
They run downstairs, right? Then to the basement, and he is getting sucked, I guess, to like the ghost dimension through the trunk. Craig is. And that's when Ironside's, like, not having it. And instead of, like, shooting her or trying to kill her, he gives her the crown.
Mm-hmm.
And then kisses her, you know, like, and makes her the prom queen. And that apparently satisfies her. So then Craig is able to escape from the trunk. And Ironside disappears into the ghost dimension with her. And so Craig is free. And then, luckily, Vicki is safe in the ghost dimension because she's covered in ectoplasm or goo or whatever.
She comes out in her nice conservative gear.
Yeah, she's back in her like conservative garb, and he rescues her from the trunk, and they have a little quip about coffee because there's a moment early on about coffee, like, how do you take it or whatever.
She's like, "That stuff will kill you."
Yeah, talking about
sugar. This is my girl.
Yeah, this is my little conservative Reaganite. And then they make out, and They're safe, and they get outside, and like the sirens are going off, and everybody's like, "What happened here? What insanity took place here?"
And we get our Nightmare on Elm Street / Tales from the Crypt ending.
Yes, we get our little twist ending. Ironside shows up, and he's like, "Come on, kids, let's get out of here." And he's being really nice to them, and they're like, "Okay, thank God, we're free." They get in the car, and then in a very Tales from the Crypt, Phantasm 2 style ending, he locks the doors, he turns the radio on, and it's 50s rock and roll.
Well, it's Hello Mary Lou.
Right.
Song, yeah.
And he looks back at them with like a gleam in his eye, and he's like, says some 50s slogan thing. Mm-hmm. And then they take off screaming in the car, and then the camera pulls up to the full moon and credits.
Yeah, and it was a quick, tight 97 minutes. No useless filler, really. The timing on this was great.
Yeah, this is a blast to watch from start to finish. This is the third time in like a month you've watched this,
yes,
right?
Yeah.
So like, it's a blast to watch. I love this movie. When we found out, when we were looking up the list of the November releases and we found out that this one came out in November, I was like, can we please do this? Because it's such a fun movie.
Yeah, no problem. Let's do it.
Yeah, and it was perfect for us to kind of watch right before Halloween. I know this episode is now out after Halloween, but we watched it right before. And if you plan on watching this again, definitely save it for your next 31 days of Halloween, because it's a great, spooky, Tales from the Crypt-esque horror effects extravaganza.
Yeah. All right, let's stop this, rewind it, eject. We'll come back with the behind the scenes.
In the name of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, amen.
Forgive me, Father, for I have sinned. I have done terrible things. I have hurt my friends. I have given into sexual desires with my boyfriend. I don't know what's happening to me.
We all stray from the path of the Lord sometimes, child. But with penance, you will find your way again.
Will you help me, Father?
Of course, child.
Will you pray for me?
Yes.
Will you fuck me? Come on, buddy. It's a big, free country. Right, buddy?
Dear God.
Let's blast these people with some knowledge.
Yeah, so we've taken the tape out, and what went into this? What's going on with Prom Night 2?
Prom Night is a whole little universe here. It's yes. kind of interesting. I did not know going into this that it had so many. We had the 1980 with Jamie Lee Curtis,
which is considered a classic, but neither of us really like that much.
No, it's boring.
Yeah, it's kind of a slow, boring movie. I hate the soft filter that's over the whole thing. I'm not a fan.
Yes, the soft filter, which we've actually seen that in Missing in Action 3.
Yeah, they used that soft focus lighting for the first half of that movie, too.
Can't stand it.
Yeah, any movie that does that, I'm immediately turned off. So Prom Night, I'm not a fan, but yes. I am a huge fan of Prom Night 2.
Well, Prom Night has the highest rating, because I went through and looked through all these. It has a 42% on the tomato meter, which I'm like, maybe, fine. I would give it more of like a 30, 35.
People like it, though. Yeah. People like this movie.
Then we move into Hello, Mary Lou, Prom Night 2 in 87, and it only got a 30% on the tomato meter, and I really disagree with that.
Yeah, I mean, it's not a great research tool or anything like that, but I looked at the Wikipedia for this movie as well, and it also mentions on there that when this movie came out, it was generally negative reviews. But some of the reviews, like the one mentioned on the back from the Washington Post, get it, though. Like, the people that did review it well always mention like the humor of the movie and like the sort of tone of fun that this movie has. So a couple reviewers at the time got it, but mostly negative reviews.
Then the franchise goes really downhill. We have Prom Night 3, The Last Kiss, which is not on Amazon. So the first, second, and fourth you can all stream on Amazon Prime. The third one, not on there, and it's very difficult to even get a copy of it.
Yeah, so if you don't already have the original VHS of it, which is very hard to find, the DVD that Artisan put out in the late 90s or early 2000s, whatever it was, is the TV edited version of the movie. So not only is it like a 4:3 aspect ratio DVD, it is cut, severely cut. So the only way to see the movie uncut is on VHS, or if you find a bootleg of it. So this one's hard to find. This one's hard to get a hold of. So I have not seen it yet. I just recently came into one. So I'm going to watch it at some point, and maybe in like a half episode we do, I can let you know what I thought of it, but this one was hard to track down.
Yeah, for research, I watched 1, 2, and 4, mostly because they were all on Amazon Prime, and right. I could. Prom Night 4, Deliver Us From Evil, 1991. That's a 0% on Rotten Tomatoes. There weren't a lot of critics who did it. But only 13% of the audience, and that was like 2,000 people. So this film is not liked. And I can tell you one thing. I watched it. It's boring.
Yeah, you said it was trying to get back to like the first one, yeah, which was boring anyway.
Yeah, it's trying to get back to its slasher roots. It's just a psycho priest goes nuts and kills sinners. To me, I think the beginning and the kind of the first half and the second half, I wonder if it was two different films they combined, because a lot of the scenes seem odd. If you ever watched a movie where they do that, you notice like one part of the movie, none of the characters interact with the other part of the movie.
Right.
So none of them see each other until the priest interacts with both. But to me, they could have just easily gotten an actor that looked like him, or it is the same one. I don't really know. It's boring. Honestly, skip it. I only for completists do you have to put yourself through this.
Eventually I'll see it. I know I will because I am a completist, but I am very excited to check out 3 because 3 is another Mary Lou story.
Yes.
It's not the same actress, unfortunately, because she's fucking amazing in this movie. But
other than Hamilton High,
that's the only
connecting thing between all 4 of these, because 1 has nothing to do with 2. 2 and 3 have something to do with each other with Mary Lou, and then 4 just drops off the planet, but still at Hamilton High. Funny thing is in the fourth movie, they don't even go to prom. They skip it. That's the whole point of the story. Is they're skipping it to get to the rich kid's like parents' summer home to get down and dirty.
Gotcha. Well, I'll watch it at some point. I probably will find something I like in it because it's from 91. It's a good time for like B-level sequels and stuff like that. So I'll probably find something I like in it, but I'm sure it's dreadful.
Yeah,
I'm very much looking forward to 3. Now, I've seen, and you haven't seen this one yet, I've seen the remake of Prom Night.
I considered renting it for $2.99, but then I told myself, no.
You're better than that. Save your $3. What an awful, awful movie. And not because, you know, it's a PG-13 remake of a slasher movie. Not because of that reason. I mean, that alone should be the problem. But the problem with the remake is that it is boring. Nothing happens in it. It is a movie about nothing. And the killer in the movie isn't like a slasher, it's just a dude in a baseball hat.
Yeah, you mentioned that the costume
is a baseball hat. Like, yeah. Very, very, very simple, like no effort. And I feel like that's a good summation of the movie. It's every lazy, easy choice that it can make, it makes. So by the time it's over, it is just boring. And I like the trashy teen movies from the 2000s, like When a Stranger Calls and things. I enjoy those for trash reasons. This one's not even fun. This one's not even worth watching.
Well, it even has Idris Elba in it.
Yeah, who is wasted. Who is just completely and totally wasted.
And Brittany Snow, which is a good-looking leading lady in a way. She's part of the Pitch Perfect, but she's really young in this, and you told me, do not waste your money. I looked at it and was kind of like, I don't want to. But really, what totally sealed the deal of me not watching it was that stupid poster.
Yeah, I actually kind of like the poster, but it is stupid. But I like it.
Well, what I don't like about it is, first of all, how does the tiara fall down there? Maybe I'm getting a little too nitpicky, but I hate this whole Photoshop, just put the blue overlay on it. I'm so tired of it.
Yeah, 2008. Yeah, definitely, as far as the franchise go, just skip it. Don't even bother with the remake. We'll get back to you on 3, though.
Yes. So we're going to go behind the scenes of the actual movie we watched, Prom Night 2. This was originally meant to be a standalone film. It was written as a standalone film, and the title of that was The Haunting of Hamilton High.
Yeah, you can kind of tell because it's not a slasher movie per se. It's a supernatural slasher. Mm-hmm. I believe that it would be a separate movie. That's what works so well about it, though. That's the best thing about it.
It jumps so far away from the first film, which is a slow-paced slasher with a disco dance.
Right. This is like an 80s prom Tales from the Crypt effects heavy movie.
So I'm assuming the writer got this down and he's just paying homage to everything. He wants to make a zany comedy horror with the leading lady basically being Carrie, and then they stepped in and they're like, well, so when it was bought, I guess the rights were ended up buying by the Samuel Goldwyn company, they stepped in and said, like, no, we're going to capitalize on this Canadian slasher Prom Night. We're going to reshoot half of it and then release it as Prom Night 2.
Right, and Ron Oliver was the one who did the reshoots, it said, mm-hmm. when we were researching it. So he, you know, restructured his script, which is probably why it's so cohesive. This does not feel like a reshoot movie
at all.
Yeah, this
wasn't.
He was the one who originally scripted the film as it was haunting at Hamilton High. He's the one that restructured it to a Prom Night sequel, so I think that's why it's so cohesive.
I don't know how many I've seen, but this might be the best reshot movie I've ever seen, especially with that much being reshot.
Yeah, it's because they maintain a spirit of fun from start to finish. Mm-hmm. I think that's what helps. A lot of these reshoot movies get so bogged down in exposition and mythology and stuff like this. This one's like, fuck it, let's have a good time.
Yeah, and the one thing in this film that I noticed right away was how damn good the music was.
Yes, so we noticed that the composer for this movie did all four of the originals. From a boring kind of disco score in the first one, comes in with this 80s synthy, just a blast of a theme throughout this movie.
This is great, and he's done actually quite a bit of them. I mean, you said all four, but he's done My Bloody Valentine, Porky's, A Christmas Story.
Yeah,
I mean,
all the Canadian production. He must be the go-to Canadian guy.
He's the go-to Canadian man. I'm just going to read you off a few of the fantastic tracks on this. We had Hello, Mary Lou, and this one was performed by Ricky Nelson. But we also had Mary Lou, which was performed by Ronnie Hawkins. We had Tutti Frutti by Little Richard. And then we had a couple of the other ones that were performed by the Partland Brothers for this. And they're actually, I mean, for good cheesy 80, you've got Outside the City and Soul City.
Yeah.
So, I mean, this was a fun soundtrack.
Yeah, this is a great soundtrack. And I'm sure the 50s songs, like the Little Richard and the Ricky Nelson and A Little Darling by the Diamonds, these were not cheap. These could not have been cheap. So like,
Tutti Frutti had to be a good like $20,000.
Yeah, like, I mean, it's not as expensive and exorbitant as they are today in the 80s, but like there was no way. They shelled out good cash for these.
Yes. So we've got the distribution companies here. We got Alliance Atlantis, which was a famous Canadian one that had lasted quite a bit. Mm-hmm. At one time, it was bought up by Goldman Sachs, and the whole company finally folded in 2013.
Yeah, they were around forever. They a lot of the Canadian releases would get still released here. Because I have an Atlantis Black Christmas remake and an Atlantis Wrong Turn.
Yeah, they slowly trickled down mm-hmm. to the United States. You can find them all over.
Yeah.
Now, the U.S. distribution of this was by the Samuel Goldwyn Company, which I guess came in and just bought a bunch of stuff and then reshot all this. Because if you know the Samuel Goldwyn Company, they're very interesting. It's the son of the G in MGM.
Right.
So I guess his name is Samuel Goldwyn Jr., who we're talking about. I actually know this distribution company from my animation background, or at least the animation background of going to school for it. This is the same company that gave Don Bluth all of his animations, you know, where you had Rockadoodle, American Tail, and Land Before Time. They also did the Care Bears movie.
Yeah.
Don Bluth didn't, but
Samuel Goldwyn released it.
Yes.
And we found out that Virgin was, we talked about it a little bit at the beginning, but Virgin released the VHS when this came out on video, where it was more successful.
Yes, much more successful. So I'm assuming they just gave them the rights to distribution.
Yeah, home video distribution only, yeah.
Samuel Goldwyn Company is interesting because they ended up selling a couple times of really scattering their movies. Eventually, MGM, Daddy's company, ended up buying everything.
Right.
Or at least the majority, because you also said Sony got a
Sony had handled a lot of their current releases, and I think MGM sort of got the catalog. I think that's how they split it.
Yes,
it appears to be, like, because MGM eventually released this movie than on DVD in the 2000s.
2002, yeah.
So Shout Factory needs to hurry up and get in on this and get this out on Blu-ray.
I would love to see what they could get for this.
Yeah, because Shout and MGM have a good working relationship. So if MGM still is holding on to this from the Goldwyn catalog, Shout should really jump in and give this movie a proper release, because Synapse already handled the first one, so Shout should come in and handle this one.
Which I will never buy. No. Sorry, Synapse. I love you guys, but I don't want anything to do with that.
To their credit, their restoration of it, that's what the last time I saw the movie was their restoration. They cleaned it up fantastically. It looks great.
I mean, they do such a great job. Yeah.
But the movie sucks. So
I bought popcorn not too long ago, and their restoration of that looks great. That Blu-ray of popcorn is fantastic. Never saw the movie, and it's great.
Yeah, I love the movie. I picked that one up too, but I haven't watched the Blu-ray yet.
Well, it came out in 1991, which is a really bad time period for horror comedy.
Yeah, but it was a great film for that time.
It was a great film, but it didn't do very well.
Mm-mm.
No. So let's get back to the Prom Night universe here. Now, if you're looking for this on DVD or Blu-ray, this is very difficult. Like you mentioned before, Prom Night 2 came out in MGM, and they basically took the 4:3 of it and just expanded it to full, and it looks
Yeah, they bad. Did. MGM at the time, because I had to rebuy, but I had a Terminator disc where they did this as well. Instead of releasing the, you know, master in 2:35 or whatever they shot in, 1:78, whatever, they would take a 4:3 scoped movie. This is getting extra nerdy. This is where people turn us off. They took a 4:3 scoped movie and smashed it so it was stretched, and then also just added fake black bars, not the actual, mm-hmm. like, adjust to your TV black bars. Added the fake black bars, which then cut off the bottom of the frame.
So, tops and bottom.
Yeah, it's top just, and bottom of the frame. So you're losing the picture and it's stretched. They did that. I'm assuming that's what they mean when they say that this was chopped up by the 4:3, because they did that with Terminator as well. MGM was just trying to kick out. 2002 was a big time for DVDs. Yeah. They were just trying to kick out as many as possible. So they cheated us that way. So it's actually, we would always recommend to pick up the VHS. But in this case, if you can find the VHS, get that instead of the DVD, because DVD is going to look like shit and you're going to miss some of the picture.
Yeah, we don't say that often, but the best way to get this is on VHS. But the whole collection can be tough too, because I found a couple of the Prom Night collections, and the Australian one is in Region 4, so you can't even play that.
With... And that's the only one that has all four together.
Yes. And then we found a UK Region 2, which I don't even know how many of those were in there.
Yeah, it was still a collection, but who knows how many were even in that one.
Yeah.
And America, you can get the first one anywhere, because for a while it was public domain before Synapse came in, and I think they've sort of, you know, moved it from public domain, have a certain level of rights to it now. But that was public domain. This one was with MGM, and then 3 and 4 were with Artisan, who is now Lionsgate, and they did the shitty release I was talking about that has the TV cut version of 3 on it. So that's out of print, I think, now, too.
Oh, yeah, I'm
so
sure.
These movies are really hard to find, except for the first one.
Yes, you basically have to go on eBay to get them.
Mm. And just, get the VHS at this point. Until somebody like a Shout comes in and gives it a proper Blu-ray release, just stick to the tape.
Yes. All right, well, let's come back and then we'll do what's going in the museum.
Yeah.
This is the second time I've had to reclaim my property from you.
It belongs in a museum.
So do you.
This is where Analog Jones figures out what's going to go in the museum. Are we going to learn? Are we going to have something crappy we got to learn from? Or did we find some gold?
Well, I found some gold. And mine is sort of... Let me explain it. Basically, the end scene of the movie, when Mary Lou starts wreaking havoc on the prom, is basically Carrie. It's what it is. But, because this is from 1987, we get the 80s updated version of the Carrie prom scene. So we have neon lights everywhere. Everything is exploding, including her tombstone for some inexplicable reason. Everything is exploding with sparks and flames. So I am putting in 80s Carrie scene in the museum. Revamped for the 80s, the Carrie prom torture scene.
To me, I'm putting in the character that just owned this film. She made the whole thing, and they knew, this actress knew what she was doing. I'm putting in Mary Lou Maloney's entire character.
Oh.
I want her dress, I want her gloves, I want her with the crown, and I just want her bitchiness. That
her
is
sass.
Her sass is so lovable.
Yeah, no, she is incredible. Unfortunately, this actress isn't working that much anymore, but she just gives it her all in this film.
And as a side note, as something also going in there, the actress who played Vicki, who was pretending to be her, I'm also going to put her in there too. Both of them, because it works so well. Like, at first I thought the actress playing Vicki was pretty poor. I mean, not poor, but just like, whatever.
Too meek, yeah. And too mild. Yeah.
I don't understand why they picked her, but when she does the transition, I was like, oh, that's why. Not only is she actually pretty banging once you get her out of that conservative... again, I said the banging.
Banging.
Are we the only two that uses this?
Banging.
We need to know. But anyway, both these girls are good looking, but they own the time they're on the actual camera.
So you're putting in the museum the embodiment of Mary Lou.
Yes, let's go with that.
Nice.
I like it.
Nice.
It was, well, I guess we'll skip right on to this. Matt, do you recommend that our viewers watch Hello Mary Lou, Prom Night 2?
If you are strolling through a resale shop or a place that sells VHSs and you come across Mary Lou Prom Night 2, pick that fucker up immediately. If it's $10, do it, because none of the DVDs are going to look as good anyway. Scoop it up. Do it. Do it.
I completely recommend it. I'm right there with you. This was fun. I had never seen this film until you decided, oh, please let us do this for it. I'm like, okay. Luckily, it was on Amazon Prime, and I didn't have to wait for you to bring over the VHS. This was so much fun, and like I've said, in like a span of 3 weeks, I've watched it 3 times.
Yeah. Yeah. So, absolutely, absolutely pick this one up. For sure, and definitely keep it on your rotation for your October watches. I know, yeah, we're in November now, and you have to wait 11 months, but like, keep it around for that rotation.
It's got that
of
great
October.
Fall feel.
Yeah, I mean, even in November, yeah, it's great. That's when it came out in theaters. It definitely has a fall feel. Do it.
Now we're gonna go into what we're watching. So Matt, do you have anything that you want to recommend?
That I'm watching now?
That you just watched recently, like for October or something like that.
Oh, no. No.
All right, we'll come back to Matt. I actually watched the Cult of Chucky, the new Chucky film that just came out. Overall, I'm going to say it's kind of like a C movie to me. I enjoy the charisma of Brad Dourif. And Jennifer Tilly actually... Oh, so spoilers. Jennifer Tilly comes back. I don't know if that was a spoiler.
No.
So the whole thing is they're just trying a new thing. It's not a soft reboot or anything like that. They're trying something new, and I give them that. I think I'm just kind of tired of the whole franchise.
I don't know. I like this one. I didn't love it, but I did really like it. I had a good time with it. The gore is good. Chucky's fun to watch. I think he looks great in this one, too. The effects are... to being top notch.
That's the thing, is like Brad Dourif is very charismatic. So is Jennifer Tilly. I liked the little kind of animatronic / CG doll that they used for it. I kind of dug what they're doing with it. I think it was just Brad Dourif's daughter in it, which you told me was the lead actress for it. I feel like they're introducing a new character to it. They're trying really hard to make her part of the whole universe here, and I just don't care about her character.
Yeah, I mean, I'm more interested in like Andy's back in this one.
Yeah,
that's not even a spoiler, that's in the first scene. Andy's back in this one, and I'm more wanting to see his character, and then another character after the credits shows up from another one of the movies that I'm interested in seeing them join up. And you know, I read an interview with the director that he's doing like a Fast Five thing with the franchise, which I'm interested in that movie. That said though, while Fiona Dorff's character is sort of the newest addition, I think she's a welcome addition for me. I like the character, but I do want to see the old school characters back.
No, her performance wasn't bad or anything like that. I just want to see Andy, Chucky, and Tilly.
Yeah, and I think we will. I think that's coming. So next week we will be doing a half episode. So if you're following the podcast, you've seen that last week we did a half episode.
Mm-hmm.
And then we're here for this week. We're doing another half episode, and that's where we'll announce the next full episode we're doing. So definitely give that a listen. But the movie we're going to talk about in the half episode, you know, it's Halloween season, so we've got movies to pick from that aren't necessarily VHS related. We're gonna talk about Happy Death Day, which is in theaters now. We talked about Jigsaw in our last half episode, and yeah, we'll, you know, 20 minutes. We'll just shoot the shit about Happy Death Day. We'll announce what we're gonna do next on VHS, because I know that's what you guys are actually here for.
Goodbye, heart, sweet Mary.